Broadcasting across California, California's only statewide political show. You're watching The Issue Is.
That video shot by our guest this week, Congresswoman Norma Torres, during the attack on the U.S. Capitol. Welcome to The Issue Is. I'm Elex Michaelson. This week, our big issue, where do we go from here after these extraordinary scenes? With us now is the Democratic Congresswoman Norma Torres from Pomona. She represents California's 35th district. Congresswoman, welcome to The Issue Is for the first time.
Thank you so much, Alex. It's really good to be with you and your viewers today.
And we are glad that you are safe after what happened this week. Paint us a picture for us, if you will, of what that experience was like. And I know you have many pictures that you tweeted out as well.
It was a horrific experience. Certainly, I was expecting tension there on the floor. I wanted to be a part of this historic moment. It's the reason why I asked to be on the floor. I wasn't able to go to the floor because of social distancing guidelines, but I was allowed to be one of 12 members that were watching the ceremony from the balcony, which was really the worst place to be since the ambush took place there. There was nowhere for us to go. Every door was blocked with people trying to do us harm.
And Congresswoman, you actually were a 911 dispatcher in the past as well. I'm sure you were thinking about some of that experience.
I just want to thank, the LAPD for the 17 and a half years of training that I had while I was a 911 dispatcher, thinking about, surviving situations and not being focused on the moment, but being focused on and planning for what was to come next. We had one officer on the site that where I was at who, acted very quickly. We heard the gunshot. He told us to hit the ground. After that, he told us to put on a mask, which, at that moment, there was so much going on that I was yelling back saying, I have my mask on. I'm thinking, foolishly thinking about my COVID mask. He was referencing, the gas mask that we needed to put on because tear gas had been deployed. It was a surreal moment that I will never forget.
And you said shortly after that that, you've fled Guatemala to get away from some of this. Tell us about your family's journey and how that was informing your thinking while in the midst of this trauma.
As a little girl, my parents sent me to the U.S. From Guatemala. There was a civil war there, and my parents didn't feel that I was safe there. As a toddler, we had been involved in an incident where we were being chased by people who were shooting a gun at the truck that my father and my mother and I were in. My parents literally, used me as a human shield, put me there on the window to try to send a message to the people that were chasing us to stop firing because there was a child in the car. So imagine that moment, which it seems incredible, but here we are in the United States of America. Within the compounds and the safety and security of the U.S. Capitol, to have to go through something even worse than that experience. Because this wasn't one person shooting at us. This was an angry mob who were ready to do us harm.
So, big picture, how do you think this happens? I know you believe that President Trump deserves some of the blame, but this is bigger than just President Trump. How did we get here?
What happened on Wednesday is a culmination of his words, his actions, and the complicit group of members on both sides of the House and the Senate and in the House that have allowed and refused to stand up to this American bully. President Trump is a traitor, and every single one of the people who has not stood up to him continues to be a traitor to our country.
To that point, do you support the impeachment of President Trump? And at this point where we are taping on Friday, where are things at on that front?
I want him out of the White House. I think the quickest way to do that and the most orderly way to do that is for Vice President Pence to do the right thing and to move forward and invoke the 25th Amendment. I have signed on to impeachment bills.
Where are we at? Because we're hearing some reports that we may have a vote on this early next week. Is that what you're hearing?
We are hearing that we may be called, you know, to vote on this early next week. You know, if it can be done, you know, that quickly, well, that is great. I think that there is enough evidence and video and all of what is required to put on this trial.
So there are those, though, who say, look, if you impeach President Trump, all that's going to do is inflame his supporters even more. There's only a handful of days left in the administration. Why stoke the flames? What do you say to that?
President Trump is mentally unstable. We cannot allow him to continue as head of this nation. We have domestic threats every single day. I am pleading with Vice President Pence, do the right thing. Remember that President Trump sent people to also threaten you. You have to be evacuated. And prioritize our nation, our Constitution, the rule of law, before prioritizing the needs of an unruly and unstable person in the White House.
This has been a tough and traumatic week for everybody, but we do like to have a little bit of fun on this show. We all could use a little bit of a break, right? So this is something we do called Personal Issues. It's a 30-second game to get to know you a little bit better. It's your first time on the show, you ready?
Yes.
Okay. What is your favorite TV show to binge watch?
My favorite TV show, believe it or not, was House of Cards.
Felt like that this week. Favorite movie?
My favorite movie is an old-time favorite, Something About Mary.
Okay, cool. Favorite musical artist or band?
My favorite...
Band or musical artist?
Okay, I have not slept in almost 3 days. Beyonce.
Okay, there you go, the queen. And last question to wrap up on, who's your role model?
Right now, my role model and my hero are those Capitol Police officers that were sent out to do a job without proper equipment, without proper guidance, and without proper information about the ambush that was going to happen. But many of them stood up and used their own bodies to help protect not just members of Congress, but the people that were there to witness a ceremony that should have just been that, a ceremony.
Mm. So many heroes to profile this week. Congresswoman
you.
Torres, thank you so much.
Okay, take care. Bye-bye.
Up next, one of the most plugged-in reporters in the country, Anna Palmer, joins me. But first, a programming note to tell you about. In 2 weeks, join us for a very special edition of The Issue Is as we report from Washington, D.C. during the inauguration of Joe Biden and Kamala Harris. More of this week's show when we come back.
In calling for this seditious act, the president has committed an unspeakable assault on our nation and our people.
House Speaker Nancy Pelosi calling for the removal of the president of the United States, one of so many unforgettable moments from this week. Anna Palmer is one of the most plugged-in reporters on all of Capitol Hill. For years, she helped to write the Politico Playbook, a daily email newsletter which pretty much everyone who's influential in Washington reads every day. Her book with her colleague Jake Sherman is called A Hill to Die On, The Battle for Congress and the Future of Trump's America. And just this week, she helped to launch a brand new journalism company called Punchbowl News, with its own daily newsletter and a lot of reporting on The Hill. Anna Palmer, welcome to The Issue Is. And what a week to launch a company focused on Capitol Hill. I mean, craziness. And as someone who has spent so much time in that building, what was your emotional reaction to those images this week?
It's been a really tough week. I've worked for a long time in the Capitol every day. And I think what's so jarring is there's such a sense of decorum and a kind of a bubble around the Capitol. I often, would tell my mom, don't worry, I'm in the safest place possible. I'm in the U.S. Capitol. There's police here. They're guarding us. You usually can't walk, more than 5 or 10 feet without running into police. You go through magnometers to get into the building. You have to have a press badge or a staff badge. And to see just the chaos and the just lawlessness at a place that it's so jarring to me that I'm still kind of processing it because it's hard for me to even understand.
And the Republican Party seems to be processing it, too, in terms of where do they go from here. We've seen from your own reporting at Punchbowl breaking this week that there was apparently a screaming match between Congressman Kevin McCarthy, the Republican from Bakersfield, the minority leader, and the president of the United States, who we know he's been very close with for years. Fill us in. What happened here?
Yeah, Kevin McCarthy has been one of Donald Trump's closest allies on Capitol Hill, and that relationship really came to a big friction point on Wednesday. He called the president. They got into a screaming match. We broke that news over the fact that the minority leader, McCarthy, wanted the president to put out a statement to call off his supporters that had turned into this mob as the Capitol was under assault. The president at first refused. Then he finally put out a Twitter statement, which was not what the leader wanted. And he finally then put out a video, as we all saw. But I think there was massive frustration, not just from Kevin McCarthy, but from Republicans in general, that the president had basically fomented this rally into a charging mob of protesters onto the Capitol, calling for them to go to the Capitol, and that he had really incited this violence.
Where did the Republican Party go from here in terms of President Trump? We know so many of them have been so loyal, among them Kevin McCarthy. Does that change?
We're starting to see some real friction point here. I do agree with you. The Republican Party, oftentimes there's been things that have happened, and you've been wondering, when are they going to break, right? This must be the breaking point. And we are seeing more of that. There's been a lot of Republicans who have called out the president, who have said what he did was wrong. But there still are, particularly in the House of Representatives, a lot of Republicans who support him, who even after the rioters were cleared of the building and they went back to doing the people's business of certifying the election, still voted against the certification in Arizona and in Pennsylvania.
From our last guest here on The Issue is Congresswoman Norma Torres. She's telling us that there's likely to be an impeachment vote next week in the House. Based off of everything you know and all the people that you know, on January 19th, is Donald Trump still the president of the United States?
It is very hard to crystal ball what is going to happen when Donald Trump is involved. I think we, as reporters, do that at our own peril, frankly, because nobody knows what the president is going to do but himself. Certainly, we are hearing that, he is in a very bad place, kind of emotionally. He's very frustrated. I do think, House Democrats appear to right now be figuring out how this impeachment process could work.
What would have been the big story in a normal week, what you guys probably thought was going to be the big story this week, was the Georgia Senate runoffs, Democrats winning both seats, which seemed unlikely a few weeks ago. So that means we're going to have a Democratic majority, barely, January 20th. What does that mean for the average person? What does a Democrat Senate actually mean for them?
It's a fundamental power shift in Washington, which is what we spend a lot of our time covering, because who has power is translates to everything else in terms of what gets actually done. So all of a sudden, in an all-Democratic Washington, Joe Biden doesn't have to worry about getting his cabinet secretaries approved and the delays and the tactics that Republicans would likely have used to try to stall some of those people from getting put into place. It also means that his agenda can likely be, much more bold than it would have been under a divided government. Still, I will note, I think for Democrats who think all of a sudden they're going to get every single priority passed, these are very, very, very tight majorities. The Speaker only has a 5-seat majority in the House, and to thread the needle with the vast kind of progressive wing of the party and the more conservative Democrats is going to be something that she's going to have to tangle with. And obviously in the Senate, it's a 50-50 Senate that's going to be a tiebreaker with your former home state Senator Kamala Harris in the vice president's seat. So expect COVID relief, stimulus talks, things like that. But I wouldn't expect that all of a sudden you're going to see Joe Biden take a real veer to the left.
And you could see some nice leverage for the few moderate Republican senators as well, because if they're able to cross over against the over the aisle, that could they could be able to deliver some stuff as well there. All right, we've got to pause for 1 second, but up next, more with Anna Palmer on the future of news and media. But before we go to break, we encourage you to check out our website, theissueisshow.com. Send us an email as well. We'll be right back.
Punchbowl News.
That there is the promotional video for Punchbowl News, the new journalism company founded by John Bresnahan, Jake Sherman, and our guest, Anna Palmer, one of the most connected reporters in Washington, D.C. Anna, welcome back. Congratulations again on the new site. So what is Punchbowl News? Because there's a lot of different people covering politics in Washington, D.C. What makes it unique? How does it work?
Absolutely. We are thrilled that we launched January 1st, went into a very busy week, obviously, but Punchbowl News is basically focused on power in Washington. If you want to understand what happens, how it's going to happen, what their motivations are, we are the news outlet that's for you. Our credo is power, people, politics. That's what we cover. It's kind of the inside game. But I truly believe that if you are interested in what has happened in this last election, if you want to actually understand what the officials are going to do or not do, we are the outlet for you. Unbiased, nonpartisan reporting with a lot of analytics and analysis around these people because we've been covering them for a really long time. We made a bet that we wanted to go out on our own. I think right now you're in a really dynamic environment where you can go out, and there's a lot of independent creators that are leaving big companies to go start their own, you know, single, you know, kind of newsletters through Substack and other different mechanisms. We feel like we're an individual content creator plus. We want to basically give information to folks that are focused on power Washington and do it through, right now it's newsletters because that's where a lot of people in Washington live on their phones. We have a free newsletter. You can subscribe at punchbowl.news. We also have a premium product, which is an afternoon and an evening product. But I think we're going to evolve and we're going to experiment. And that's one of the most exciting things about this entrepreneurial experience is we can do a lot of things, try different things out, see what resonates with our community.
And a question just about you, because covering President Trump for the last 4 years has got to be pretty exhausting, right? We're now coming to the end of the Trump administration. And I'm wondering, maybe that's just because I need help, but how do you balance it all?
My fiance, Patrick, Patrick Melody. He's a good balancing factor. You love your job, and I think this reporting in Washington is a 24/7 job, but certainly I think you have to find outlets, whether that's working out, whether that's friends, whether that's going. I really love to travel, which unfortunately in COVID has been, we have not been able to do, but we're hoping that with the vaccine, we'll be able to get out there and get away after the successful launch of this in a few months.
Well, I hope you all can take a deep breath. Anna Palmer, thank you so much for all the work that you've done. You've helped me understand the place better, and I encourage people to sign up for Punchbowl News. I already have, and I've already learned a lot in just a week. So well done, congratulations, and thanks for being on The Issue Is.
Thanks.
When we come back, my commentary on the chaotic week that was and how all of us have a role in ensuring that this doesn't happen again. Stay with us. After this week's chaos in our capital, America is at a fork in the road. Where we go from here is really up to us. It is very possible that this attack further divides us, and the president's supporters feel even more disconnected and radicalized. Under that scenario, this is just the beginning of a series of attacks. But it is also possible that this could be the moment when the fever finally starts to break, and at least some of the people who know better realize the damage they are doing by lying to their supporters and dehumanizing their political opponents for selfish gains. Why do they do it? Right now, our media, social media, and politics mostly rewards division and simplicity and penalizes compromise and nuance. Think about it. The most outrageous comments often are the most discussed on cable news and shared out the most in your social media feeds. Those systems reward simple, emotional reactions, which are often based on fear or anger. Now, some of that is human psychology and cannot easily be fixed, but there are things that we can do. One, our education system needs to be more sophisticated at media literacy training fit for the 21st century so young people can more easily diagnose what actually is fake news. Second, our media and our social media companies need to take more responsibility for their own actions and may need more regulation. But there's also a role for all of us, we the people. If we want better local journalism, subscribe to a local paper. If you want more nuanced discussions in social media, share some of those out in social media. If you want to see more kindness, consider volunteering for nonprofits that lift people up. If you want political candidates that better represent your values, vote for them, campaign for them, or maybe even run yourself. More than anything, media, social media, politicians all act the way they do because they think there's an audience for that type of behavior and money for them in growing that audience. But if we, the people, show there's also an audience for something better, they'll have no choice but to respond. We end this week with John Mayer's Waiting on the World to Change, because we don't have to wait on the world to change. We can change it ourselves. I'm Elex Michaelson. Thanks for watching The Issue Is.